from mainland China, you know, decreases rule of law is one of their important markers for economic freedom. Mm. And China, as a matter of fact, in this survey that was just released, was ranked 115th out of 150 countries. So while China may have economic freedom, they don't have personal freedom, they don't have rule of law, they don't have a lot of the things that we as libertarians would value in a free society. So they're ranked pretty low by the Fraser Institute, believe it or not.
So I think it's interesting the things that the Fraser Institute finds that are wrong in the United States. And right up there is protection of property rights, including the abuse of eminent domain and the taking of property by various regulatory agencies, sure, whether it's EPA or ESA or whatever.
And
to domestic wars, the war on terror and the war on drugs.
Well, yeah.
Both of which have...
We might call personal freedom.
But they have a very strong economic impact.
They do.
Through asset forfeiture, among other reasons.
Yeah, the horrors there. It's, yeah.
So, well, we have a long ways to go before we can righteously
regain our number two ranking.
Our role as the leader
of the
free market.
Get rid of the war on drugs, get rid of the war on terror, and we're... We're back in
the So the Fraser Institute's worth looking up.
No,
for
absolutely,
everybody
yeah.
in the audience,
absolutely.
It's worth reading their stuff. They're very libertarian-oriented.
Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have Fred Rouse, a water efficiency technician. We also have John Cameron, the owner of TheEffectiveLeadershipCoach.com and CustomSalesTraining.com, and the author of Rewire and...
Rekill.
Two fine books. And I'm pretty sure those will go up on the screen momentarily, but the covers, so you can see what the covers look like. They're available, of course, on Amazon and other electronic booksellers, right?
Amazon,
okay. You can, you know, watch Libertarian Counterpoint on Channel 17 in Sacramento, on the web at www.accesssacramento.org, on YouTube, and on other cable channels around the area. Check your local listings for time and channel. The Republican Party really, 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 really wants to win control of the Senate and kick Harry Reid out of the lead of out of the job of majority leader. The Democrats really, 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 really want to retain control of the Senate so that they can continue, so that Obama can continue to send me all of these emails. I got on the Obama email list when I answered a. Whenever they announced that Joe Biden was going to be the VP nomination, I responded by saying, ha ha. And so I got emails addressed to ha ha for years after that. They finally figured out who I actually was, and I still get the emails. So I'm getting emails by the dozens every day from both the Obama administration or the White House or whatever, and from the Republican various committees, and they're all equally inane. What is the prognosis right now for the GOP actually successfully taking over the Senate? Key races in Louisiana, Mary Landrieu versus a couple of Republicans, a possible runoff in the cards. Arkansas, Mark Pryor versus Tom Cotton. Kansas, Pat Roberts versus an independent who actually has a chance because the Democrat evidently embarrassed himself and dropped out. The independent is Greg Orman. In Kentucky, Mitch McConnell, the minority leader, is actually facing a tough challenge from Alison Grimes. In North Carolina, Kay Hagan is running against Thom Tillis. It's a toss-up, and Libertarian Sean Haugh is polling at 11%. What's the prognosis? Who's gonna end up being majority leader come 2013? Fred?
Would it be that we had a close race between a conservative or a libertarian and a socialist in this great state of California? If only. But it looks like that's not anywhere in our near future. Most pundits are estimating the Republicans will pick up 4 or 5 seats and they'll come out with a slim majority because of the Obama hate kind of in the middle of the country and in the South. What I find most interesting about your short disquisition there is the libertarian in North Carolina. So the governor Kay Hagan, or I'm sorry, the incumbent Kay Hagan is a Democrat, And Thom Tillis, a Republican, former governor, I believe, of the state of North Carolina. And Sean Haugh, who's a pizza delivery guy, is the Libertarian candidate.
Seriously?
And, yeah, yeah. And he's in his mid-50s, and he's doing a lot. He has no money. But he has, because the state changed its laws to allow easier ballot access for libertarians from 10% in the gubernatorial race down to 2% in the gubernatorial race a few years ago, he qualifies for the ballot without gathering 10,000 signatures. So a little more ballot access in the state, and we have a libertarian. Now, Republicans will always say, oh, you libertarians, you're just going to steal vote from us Republicans. We're the true conservatives. But Sean Haugh says, no, not so fast. I mean, there are Democrats to whom the libertarian anti-war, anti-foreign wars, anti-drug war, you know, gay marriage is fine. There are Democrats to who that message is appealing. So whether this will be really interesting, I think, for the first time nationally, I think it may be that libertarians pull equally from both party bases in the election. And I think that's a good thing. I mean, I think libertarianism should, it's appealing to me, it's appealing to all of us. I think it's equally appealing to people on what we consider as the political left and the political right, because we don't think of things in left and right terms. We think of things in terms of personal freedom and economic freedom. Republicans like economic freedom, Democrats like personal freedom. We like both. So there's no good reason that that libertarians should necessarily be the nemesis of the Republican Party. They should be the the messenger for all.
Really. Well, UKIP in Britain and libertarian-leaning parties in other countries in Europe are actually taking control in some cases, I think. So if there is an electoral process in which it's possible for libertarians to get fair ballot access,
unlike here in California,
there's a base of maybe 20% of the population that's hardcore libertarian or hardcore believing small L libertarian. In other words, they believe in freedom all the way around, liberty all the way around, not just for some people, not just for their own personal predilections. That, you know, and then there's, you know, probably another, you know, maybe 10-20% of the people who are statists either on the right or on the left, totalitarians for, you know, basically people who want to rule according to their own belief system, whatever that might be, whether it's socialism or Marxism or a religious right or green or whatever. And then there's the vast majority who are in the middle, don't really pay any attention to politics, because why should you? Why should you pay attention to politics? Because really, realistically, your vote doesn't count anyway. I mean, there are very, very few, minuscule number of elections where one vote actually does make a difference. So people, public choice theory, say, well, you know what? It doesn't pay me.
Why waste my time
educating myself on all of these various issues? Most of the issues are straw men anyway. When we spend all of our time talking about women's issues, which is the Democrats' favorite bogeyman, you know, the right to abortion, the right to...
Or keeping our children safe.
Yeah, those things, those are... Right to abortion is not going away. There's no way that is going to disappear, no matter how right-wing a Republican or religious right a Republican gets elected. They simply aren't going away. There's not enough legislative support to make that happen. So it's a bogeyman. Whenever Democrats bring that up as an issue, they're using it as a divisive issue, as a wedge issue, because they haven't got anything else to talk about. Likewise, on the Republican side, whenever the Republicans talk about gay marriage or defense, again, it's a wedge issue. It's something that's being used to divide people. Most people don't care about gay marriage. You know, they could care less. Just as long as you don't make me get married in a gay marriage, I don't care if you do. You know, who cares?
I think there's something else that's going on, and more and more people I talk to, and I don't. These aren't people who do. These are people who have no vested interest in pleasing me in the conversation. These are. I talk to a lot of people at gym. I talk to people everywhere. I talk to people, and when you talk to an awful lot of people now, except for that rabid little 10 and 10% you're talking about, it's not that they don't care. It's that they see no difference between the two parties. There is no difference between the two parties. They're the parties of vested interest. They're the parties of the status quo. And they are as alike as two peas in a pod. I don't think people use that expression anymore. I think that's the real issue. And I think what's happening in other parts of the world, and maybe it's going to happen in states other than California, and eventually we'll get there, is that people realize that the status quo is the problem. It's not the Democrats, it's not the Republicans, it's whoever we put in that suit of clothes in that position to have power over us. That's the problem. What we have to do is not put people in there, but maybe get rid of some of that power. I think people are finally starting to realize
that. Well, there's that, and then the heart of that kind of it doesn't make any difference is a distrust in government in general.
Well, that's what I'm saying. They're saying that I don't trust the Republicans.
I don't believe what they're telling me.
The Democrats, they've lied to me forever. They're never going to do what they say. We need something different. I think people are finally getting to the point where they're saying we need something different. And I know that if you filed the Libertarian label off of our candidates and just put what they stood for and ask people, do you believe in that? They go, yeah, I believe in that. Do you believe in that? Yeah, I believe in that. Do you believe in that? I believe it. You would get 70%+ of the electorate supporting a Libertarian. But because they're called a Libertarian and the powers that be, the status quo folks, have succeeded in painting that as bad. Look at the job they did against calling the Tea Party radicals. And what does the Tea Party stand for? Taxed enough already. What is the radical concept they believe in? A balanced budget. Ooh, that's radical. But somehow that's been painted as radical. So the spin doctors are spinning. But if we could file that label off Libertarian candidates, they would win a lot of elections.
One of the reasons that the Democrats and Republicans are so much alike is because both parties benefit from the status quo, and they benefit from the status quo by economically they benefit because they have been able to pretty much vote themselves into a situation where they control the wealth of the country one way or another.
And one way
they do that is by controlling the banking system and the institution of money and how money is defined. It used to be money was a thing. It was gold. It was silver. It was tied, at least, to a commodity. And when that happened, you didn't have inflation. You didn't have deflation. You had a steady value for everything. Prices did not go up. Prices did not go down under a gold standard. Which is the way it should be. Actually, they went down slightly because as
efficiency and production increased, you would naturally expect prices
which is a good thing. And right now, we have a Federal Reserve that is scared out of their wits at the idea of deflation, even a little bit of deflation. Their goal is 2% inflation, which means that you lose most of your wealth in about one or two generations. It's
40 years.
Yeah, it's ridiculous what they're trying to accomplish. The Swiss, on the other hand, have figured out that there is another answer. The Swiss people put a referendum on the ballot. It's on the ballot for November 30th of this year. It would require that the Swiss central bank maintain reserves of 20% gold, and that they repatriate all the gold that's now being held in foreign banks, like the U.S. Federal Reserve or the Banks of London or wherever else it's being stored in so-called safekeeping right now.
Worried about the Nazis, are they?
Well, the Swiss are spooked by the fact that Germany tried to repatriate their gold. The Germans have something like
300 tons
of gold outside the country, stored for safekeeping.
Mostly with the Federal Reserve, the U.S. Fed.
And they said, we want it back. And the Federal Reserve or the Treasury or wherever it's stored said, we'll give it back to you. Of course we'll give it back. It'll take about 7 years to ship, a few tons of gold. And eventually they got five of their 300 tons back. And finally the Germans figured out, they don't have it anymore. We might as well just kind of cancel this order and not embarrass our ally. And the Swiss picked up on that, and they said, we're not going to we're going to call the bluff and ask for our gold back and see what can happen. Are they going to get it back? First, is a referendum going to pass? The banking system, including the Swiss central bank, is against it. And of course, world leaders are very much scared of this thing.
I think there's a chance. I don't look at the polling numbers, but the Swiss are, you know, they're the Swiss for a reason. I think there's a chance.
They're free thinkers.
Yeah, and I was going to go on a tangent about, you know, Switzerland doesn't have an army; it is an army. There's a wonderful book called Le Place de la Concorde, the Suisse, that talks about that. So they take a different approach to most things, which is why, you know, if you can stand people that don't smile a lot in the cold, Switzerland's a nice place to live. They're spooked for a very good reason. The Fed says that it has 216 million troy ounces of gold. That's 6,720 tons of gold in its vault. Now, the question is, how many times have they given that gold back to people? How many times has it been rehypothecated? Is there anything there? Is there any gold in Fort Knox?
Well, the footnote on the official statements is gold or gold equivalents, which means they've lent it out.
Yeah, gold and, or an IOU.
You know, they've
gold.
Lent it to Goldman Sachs or J.P. Morgan or somebody like that, who has sold it onto the open market. That's what's happened to the gold.
So I would say there's if there's 6,720 tons of gold in a vault somewhere in the U.S. that the Fed has control over, I will vote for Hillary in the next election. That's.
I'll go you one better. I'll vote for the whatever.
I'd kiss whatever, her on the lips if there was that much gold.
I'll vote for Bernie Sanders.
Oh my God.
the party in Switzerland that sponsored the initiative, it holds the plurality of seats in the Swiss parliament right now. So it's not just some fringe group. But like you said, they are opposed. This measure, this referendum is opposed by the Swiss National Bank. They make up scary scenarios for how, well, if we repatriated all our gold, it would be much harder to sell if we had to from here than it would be. Most of their gold's in Canada, I guess. That's what they say, not in the U.S. But
lucky them.
It would be much harder to sell it from Switzerland than it would be from Canada. And I mean, it's bogus. Nonsense. It's a complete bogus argument that they're throwing out.
I would hate dealing with the Swiss over money because everybody knows they're crooked. Right?
But they're... They are calling the bluff of the world financial system.
As well, they should.
Well, the world financial
somebody has to.
The
somebody
world financial system through quantitative easing, another word for
money printing,
or in today's day and age, actually pushing a computer button create it in a computer. Has what they've done is they've said, okay, we'll just create as much money as we damn well please, and we'll lend it to the folks who don't need
the banks.
It. You know the old saw: if you need money, nobody's going to lend it to you. If you don't need money, everybody in the world will be happy to make you a loan. Well, that's what's happening. The Federal Reserve and other central banks are increasing the money supply with abandon. And that money is not going into consumer price inflation. The reason it's not going into consumer price inflation is because those with money who don't need loans are taking out loans at 0% or 0.1% or in some cases a negative interest rate, and they're turning around and investing that money in the stock market, in the bond market. You know, that's why bonds are in houses, wherever. Fine art, gold, I'm sure. They're investing it, and as a result, we've seen up until the last couple of weeks, we've seen a stock market increase going all the way back to 2009. We've seen the bond market bond values increase as interest rates go down. We've seen the price of just about everything. Real estate is now going back up again. The 1% now of the world, the 1% of the world now controls 50% of the wealth. And that's why. It's because of central bank easy money policies, because easy money benefits the wealthy. It doesn't benefit the middle class or the
poor. It certainly doesn't benefit savers. I mean, people that have a nest egg and they're looking to
modest
live
savers.
Off of their $200,000 or $500,000 savings in retirement with a...
Forget about it.
Well, I mean, 10 years ago, we were told you could expect 6% safely, or 15 years ago. 6-8% a year safely interest on your savings. Well, now it's 0.25% or 0.5%. And so it's starving out savers is what, when you print money and you keep interest rates artificially low, you starve out people who save. Well, capitalism is based on efficient allocation and use of saved wealth. And if people are discouraged from saving and encouraged to consume, which is what low interest rates do, they're encourage buy it now because I'll never get a loan this good in the future, the savings evaporate and that money disappears because it's just fake money anyway. It's just paper money.
Well, look who benefits. Let's look, if you're going to be a little cynical, let's look at every single one of these policies and who people who are being hurt vote for and who people are being helped by this policy vote for. And if you're on some sort of government dole or government pension or government assistance, if you're a spender and not a saver, who do you vote for? You vote for
big government.
Government. If you did the right things, if you were frugal and thrifty and saved and invested, who do you vote for?
Small government.
So government policy is in place to punish people who vote against government and support people who vote for government. And it's really that simple. And you look at our tax structure is designed that way. You look at our regulatory system is designed that way. You look at the EPA is designed that way. You look at government, again, basically is creating a voting population to keep itself in power. And some cynics would even say, look at our school system. We are training idiots to vote for idiots. That's what we're doing. So
Can't argue with that.
And I'm a little bit of a cynic. So I think
a little bit.
That's going on.
Yeah,
just a little bit.
Well, I wish the Swiss.
Well, you make me look like a Pollyanna.
If the referendum passes and Switzerland has to buy gold to beef up its reserves to 20%, right now I think it's 7% of their reserves are gold, and the rest are foreign currencies, U.S. T-bills or whatever. Then that will create
real money on
market demand for gold. Yeah. And if they repatriate their gold and they're unable to get it, that will create a bit of a panic in the gold market. I mean, for
a buying panic.
Since the early 90s, the central banks around the world have been in a coordinated fashion selling gold and loaning gold in order to depress the price. In the way, the money supply has increased 20% a year for 20 years since the early 80s, and then all of a sudden now it's 30% per year. There's competitive devaluation occurring with the Bank of Japan, the European Central Bank, and the U.S. Federal Reserve to try to keep those currencies basically on par while they're all worth less. And they tell us inflation is 2%, but I don't believe it. I mean,
if you've gone to a grocery store, and I don't see how...
Education, healthcare... Insurance premiums, grocery, there's 2%. It's a lie.
That's like saying the unemployment rate is 6%. Look at the number of people, the percentage of people employed in our population compared to the Great Depression. It's actually as high right now as it was during the Depression.
It's a 30-year low of the labor market participation.
And everybody knows this, too, which is another reason why nobody trusts what the government tells us about almost anything.
But, we just need to raise taxes so everything will be okay, right? Everything will be okay if we balance the budget.
Wealth tax is the solution.
Balance the budget by raising taxes. Well, wait a minute. Fiscal 2014 U.S. tax revenues set a record of $1.4 trillion. Now, that doesn't mean a whole lot to most people, $1.4 trillion. So, but let me put that into real numbers. That's $4,429, not per taxpayer, per person. Is what the tax revenue is. And if you look at the fact that we have a deficit on top of that of another $483 billion, what the government is spending is $5,956 for every man, woman, child, and a senile grandfather in the United States. That's what's being spent.
And all we've heard is pats on the back from the people in charge that the deficit reduced by 50%. It was $1 trillion a year, and now it's only $483 billion this year.
So
we're supposed to be grateful and thankful and happy about that.
Which begs the question, Are tax revenues too low, or is spending too high?
What are we spending?
What are we spending upwards of $6,000 per person? That, you know, a family of five times $30,000 per family. What are we spending on that we get what government do we get for our $30,000?
You get a huge federal government cost to the average.
What do we get personally?
You get nothing
unless you work for the government.
The roads government. Is that what we're getting?
No.
The roads, defending the borders, are we getting that?
I don't see anybody attacking us. What do we need to defend the border for? In order for somebody to attack us, they would have to cross. There's
a couple
two,
of moats called the Atlantic and the Pacific.
Atlantic and Pacific, and if they come up through South America, well, they'd have to get there first anyway. So, and if they come down from Canada, well,
that's
they'd have
cold.
To get there first
yeah.
anyway. I mean, what do we need? We have troops in 187 countries. You could just take that off the table. Oh, that would balance the budget. Okay. So then the cost of running the federal government, the bureaucracy of it, the federal government workers earn basically double the average civilian wage.
The big argument, of course, is the Keynesian argument that our defense spending, especially domestic defense spending, we've got military bases and military industrial
facilities
all over the country.
We're taking in each other's laundry.
Yeah.
That's all we're doing.
Yeah. So we're transferring wealth from one.
That's why the healthcare cost is basically an extension of the broken window theory.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, getting a job in healthcare.
Yeah, healthcare doesn't. There's no production there, right?
Doesn't
and defense.
Anything.
I mean, yeah. defense. Yeah.
But we'll make it up by spending a whole bunch of money on green energy, right? Mm. In fact, there's a bit of a problem with that. Senator David Vitter and Representative Daryl Issa are now accusing the Environmental Protection Agency of conspiring with Natural Resources Defense Council, NRDC, in the development of carbon emission rules. What is this, the regulators and the regulated getting together?
It's worse. They have copies of Freedom of Information Act and the record keeping required by the federal government. They have copies of these emails that went back and forth between the members of the NRDC who are insiders of the Beltway to the nth degree. And then on top of that, the NRDC received over $1 million in grants from the EPA. So they're paying the clowns who are telling them what to do. And then they're shocked that anybody should question this and say, oh, no, our people put together these wonderful regulations which are going to benefit the whole world and prevent global warming, which doesn't exist in the first place.
Not to mention the revolving door between the NRDC and the EPA as far as personnel is concerned. That's the show. We'll see you again next week, same time, same place on the Libertarian Counterpoint. Thank you very much for being a part of it.